Good morning. If you'd be standing. We're going to be singing The Father's House. I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. And my story isn't over, my story's just begun. Failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does. Failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does.
Hymnals and turn to page 658. It's alive. His name.
I'm so thankful he made me a mother. I just love my kids and I love my grandkids and now my great grandkids. I just feel so blessed by not only them, but by you special friends, you Christian friends. We're going to be in heaven together someday and I'm so glad of that.
Yeah.
Our friendship won't end here on earth. We'll be together there.
Amen.
Amen. He's been so good to us. We have such a good church family. Good, tight-knit family of love. I love it. And so, all right, fellas, come on down. We'll take up our morning tithes and offerings. Bob, you want to ask a blessing?
Heavenly Father, again, we want to thank you for the many blessings you've given us. Thank you for this beautiful day, the sunshine. Thank you for providing for us and going well above our needs and blessing us so richly. Now, Lord, as we give back to you a portion of what you've given us, we pray that you would bless it, multiply it, and use it for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
ought to know that first verse, right? Some glad morning when this life is over, to do that to me once in a while. I'll pull up songs. Let's be standing. We'll sing a doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures, hear me low. Praise Him, all that the heavenly holds. Praise Father, Son,
Junior Church will be dismissed at this time. Then get your hymnals turned 625.
Before I sing this, I kind of want to talk about it. So I picked this song, you know, today's Mother's Day, and this song kind of starts out about how maybe your mom is feeling when you grow up and you leave. You're moving on, going in maybe your own home. And then it kind of goes into how you feel when you realize, oh, I'm really missing mom. I'm really missing having that support, and you feel like you're on your own. And then I'm going to switch mics because this is cut. Okay, I think that might be better. Okay, and then it kind of ends talking about how kind of your relationship with God and how
you know, sometimes in this world we feel really lost and alone. And God doesn't forget you, but sometimes we worry like, oh, what if he does forget us? He's not going to forget you. But it talks about that. So, and I do want to apologize if I cry, because she'll probably cry, and I'm hormonal. So I am sorry. I will try not to cry. And gone. For Mama, they flew by, but for me, they drug on and on. We were loading up that Chevy, both trying not to cry. Mama kept on talking, putting off goodbye. Then she took my hand and said, "Baby, don't forget. Before you hit the highway, you better stop for gas. And there's a 50 in the ashtray in case you run short on cash. Here's a map and here's a Bible. If you ever lose your way, just one more thing before you leave. Don't forget to remember me." This downtown apartment sure makes me miss home. And those bills there on the counter keep telling me I'm on my own. And just like every Sunday, I called Mama up last night. And even when it's not, I tell her everything's all right. Before we hung up, I said, "Hey, Mama, don't forget to tell my baby sister I'll see her in the fall. Tell Grandma that I miss her. Yeah, I should give her a call. Make sure you tell Daddy that I'm sorry." Don't forget to remember me. Tonight I find myself kneeling by the bed to pray. Haven't done this in a while, so I don't know what to say. Lord, I feel so small sometimes in this big old place. I know there's more important things. Don't forget to remember me. Don't forget to remember me.
Very good. Very good. Well, Brother Neil, we'll have you come up to the platform and whatever the Lord has on his heart to share with us today. And God bless you.
Do you feel like you've been worshiping God this morning? Do you feel like you've been worshiping God this morning?
Yes.
Do you really feel like you've been worshiping God this morning? Yes. There we go. Thank you. I'm hard of hearing. But, wow. Happy Mother's Day to all you mothers. Hope you're having a great day. I know it'll even get better. I was thinking about my mom. She's gone to be with the Lord almost 12 years now. But I started thinking about things in my life. And if you remember last week, I told a little about my water skiing experience and, you know, that thing I can't forget, going in the cattails. But my mom never learned to drive. She lived to be 89 years old. Never learned to drive. And there's a story all behind that. But anyway, but she never lacked getting places, which is amazing to me. I remember in summertime as a kid, you know, maybe 9, 10, whatever, that she had other mom friends that drove, and they did things together. They had kids. So we'd talk her, I'd try to talk my mama, we need to go to Bob's Lake today so we can swim in this lake. And she said no several times, and I, you know, maybe pestered her a little bit. So she called her friends and say, hey, you guys free today? We can go out to the lake and go swimming, take the kids swimming. So we do that. And I'd have a great time. My buddies would be having a great time. And I just took that for granted. You know, that's how it is. And so it's just in our day and age, somebody not driving, like one of her friends was like 65 when she finally got a driver's license, and we're saying, Mom, you know, there's hope, you can do that. No way, don't need that. And so there's story after story I was thinking about this morning, and we all have our stories, right? We have things that happen in our lives. Well, if you have your Bible, turn with me to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 1, and I want to read through this passage, and we'll come back and kind of unfold it a little bit, think about it some more go from there. So 2 Timothy chapter 1, beginning in verse 3, and you follow along as I read. Paul writes this, I thank God, whom I serve with a pure conscience, as my forefathers did, as without ceasing, I remember you in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded it is in you also. Therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Would you just bow with me for prayer? Father, we come before you this morning and we thank you for a beautiful day today. Thank you that we can honor our mothers, grandmothers, wives, children even. And Father, we thank you for bringing this together for this purpose, to worship you. And Father, we thank you so much that you have given us your word, the written word, the Bible, so we can open it up and we can learn from you, empowered by your spirit to understand it and then apply it to our lives. God, this is your service. We are here to worship you. Teach us now through your word. And we do ask this in Christ's name. Amen. All right, so I read through this passage, and I skipped a couple verses to start. So when it says, I thank God whom I serve with a pure conscience as my forefathers did, and so on, Paul is talking to someone. Paul is interesting in the fact that he has written so many letters that are found their way in the New Testament. They're God's written word through Paul, the Spirit of God, enlightening him to say exactly what needed to be said so we can understand what God's word is and what his will is. And so, but these are a little bit different type of letters. He usually writes to a local church or an area of churches, but here is a personal letter to Timothy, two of them. 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus, those three are called the pastoral letters because those young men, Timothy and Titus, were to serve God in local assemblies where they could teach and preach the word of God and help people grow in their faith. And so Paul, as he writes these things that are filled with really important information that Paul sees these young pastors need to know. And so he writes to them. A little bit of the background is when Paul is writing 1 Timothy, he is in prison in Rome. You go through the book of Acts and it ends with Paul being in prison in Rome. Well, at that time, sometime in that time, he is there. He's under house arrest. It's really not a real bad situation in prison. He has friends that can come see him anytime. But sometime in there, he wrote 1 Timothy. And in that first letter, he's got a lot of information he gives him. And then history tells us, the book of Acts ends, and history tells us that Paul was released from prison for a short while, a year or two, and then he's arrested again, and this time he's thrown into a dungeon. He's in a really dark place, and that's where he writes 2 Timothy from. So we've got Paul is the author of the book. Timothy's the receiver, or the receives that. We as believers 2,000 years later are able to glean information that's beneficial for our walk with God. And so that's a little bit of the background. Sometime aware between 66 AD and 67 AD is when he writes this letter. And there's a little bit different feel, and I don't have time to go into that, but there's a little bit different feel in 2 Timothy you don't have in 1 Timothy. It's more optimistic in 1 Timothy, and Paul understands in his situation in prison where he's at that he's going to go home to be with the Lord soon. And so he's giving Timothy some final words to help him cope with that. And that's where we find this as he begins this letter. Notice verse 1 and 2, it says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, according to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus. Remember, I mentioned last week when we went through 1 John, that John doesn't say anything about himself. Paul always says something about himself. He wants to identify himself so the author knows exactly who it is that's writing this letter. And so he says, the first thing about Paul, he mentions, I'm an apostle. So that has authority. The one who can, you need to listen to what they have to say. And Paul gives that out there. An apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. I didn't just get up one day and decide I'm going to be an apostle. No, God chose me to do what I'm doing. And we go to Acts chapter 9 and Paul's conversion and the fact that God tells Ananias, you're going to go down, go talk to Saul. I've got a job for him to do. He's going to reach the Gentiles. So he remembers all those things. According to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus, I'm an apostle by the will of God, and I've got a purpose, and I'm here to do that. And it's to you, Timothy, verse 2, to Timothy, a beloved son, grace, mercy, peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. And so we know who wrote the letter. We know who's received the letter. It's supposed to be to Timothy. We get to share in the blessings of that over the centuries as we study and see what Paul had to say to Timothy. But he identifies Timothy, and he mentions Timothy in some of his other letters because Timothy's with him when he's writing letters. But here he's writing to Timothy. And he calls him a beloved son. A beloved son. Now, it's not Paul's real son, but he's a son in the faith. If you go back to 1 Timothy chapter 1, he says, Paul calls him a true son in the faith. You are right on, Timothy. You are a godly man. You are a man that knows the word of God and shares the word of God. That's who you are. And so Paul identifies himself, again, back to 2 Timothy chapter 2, and then I come down to verse 3, which is where we start this whole list of things that happen. The reason I picked this, and I think you probably spotted as we read that, because it is Mother's Day, and there are two women named who were godly women. And so Lois and Eunice, his grandmother, his mother, were godly women who loved God, who loved Jesus Christ. And when they had opportunity in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 16 talks about Timothy's background. It says this in 16:1. Then he came, that's Paul, came to Derbe in Lystra, and behold, a certain disciple was there named Timothy, the son of a certain Jewish woman who believed, but his father was a Greek. Could mean that his father was never a believer, but here his mother was a Jewish woman who was waiting for the Messiah, and somewhere in that process, she understood that Jesus was the Messiah and received him into her life, and the same with her mother Lois. And we just have these little fractions of stuff here, but you put them together to see that God cared about these people. So it says in verse 3 again, I thank God, whom I serve with a pure conscience, as my forefathers did, as without ceasing I remember you in my prayers night and day. Timothy, first and foremost, you need to know this. Whenever I think of you, I'm praying for you. I think of those ornery people in the church that you're working with, and I have to pray for you more. You know, and so I'm telling you what you need to know, because you've got to keep going on. You got to stand fast. And so I never forget to pray for you. You're in my prayers always. And so it says, there's a list of things. In verse 3, it says, I thank God. So Paul, every time he thinks of Timothy, he gives thanks to God for what Timothy is allowed to do or able to do to touch the lives of others, to bring them into a relationship with Christ or help them grow in that relationship with Christ. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful. Are there people you're thankful for? People that have impacted your life. Maybe it is your mother, grandmother. We all have a story. We all have people in our lives. If we step and look back and see, they've had a really big part of our life as far as our walk with God is concerned. And so Paul says, I thank God because he's remembering that day he met him in the book of Acts. And he called him and said, hey, follow me. Go with me. I'm going to help you grow in your faith. And Timothy left everything behind and was following and serving with Paul. And he says, I thank God whom I serve. You see, what I am, not just an apostle, I don't do that because of my authority, but I serve God. I thank God, and I serve him with all that I am. I serve him. I thank God, I serve him, just as my forefathers did, as my heritage in Judaism and the day I met Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus. Verse 4 says, his prayers were day and night. And verse 4 says, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears, that I might be filled with joy. I thank God, I serve God, I remember you when I pray all the time. But I desire to see you. I want to see you. You know, I mentioned earlier, this is a time in Paul's life where he's preparing to leave this earth, preparing to finish his job, preparing to go and be with Jesus Christ. But he wants to leave some encouragement with this young man, Timothy. He wants to help him, because he knows Timothy's going to be heartbroken when Paul is gone. Do we understand that? I said, my mom's been gone for 12 years. You've got other people. You can raise your hands, and maybe it's not even been that long. And we grieve, right? Now, when they're Christians, we know where they are. We know where they're going. But it doesn't stop us from grieving. That's part of who it is as human beings. We have great hope. We know they're in God's presence, but still we miss them. So we grieve. And so Paul says, and I think that's what he's talking about when he says this, I'm greatly desiring to see you. I really need to see you, but in case you can't get here because I'm in prison, let me give you some stuff. And then he writes this letter. We can't cover the whole letter, but he's... What it's saying to me is there's a relationship. God holds relationships important to us. Family relationships, friendship relationships, believers' relationships. And that's the way it is. I can't follow Jesus Christ on my own. I need other people. I need other believers. We need other believers. And you probably heard this, there are no lone ranger Christians. We need each other. Even if we get mad at each other and all this other stuff, we still need each other. So that we can grow in our faith, demonstrating to the world what the love of God looks like as we love one another. And so Paul says, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears. I know if you come and see me, I'm not really in that good a shape right now, Timothy. I'm physically not doing well. And the moment you see me, because of the closeness of our relationship, you're going to shed some tears. And I'm mindful of that, but I still want to see you. I still want to be with you, that I may be filled with joy. You know, if you win someone to Christ, or God uses you to win someone to Christ, and then allows you to spend time helping them mature and grow and get stronger in their faith, you know what happens? You know what we get out of that? Joy. And I can tell you story after story of the prison and the things that I've seen there, and you'll be hearing these down the road probably. But to see a life transformed, and you've had, even whatever part you've had, whether it's prayer or whether it's teaching or whether it's just sitting by that person's side during a trial, God is working, and it brings joy. And so in verse 5, he says, and this is kind of the key verse that I wanted to think about the whole passage here. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you. Paul says, I believe you have genuine faith. What Paul is saying is, I believe when you confess your sins, when you admitted your need for a Savior, your inability to save yourself, and you cried out and saw that Jesus had paid the price for you by dying on the cross, and you said, Lord Jesus, I need you to save me because I can't save myself, and you invite Jesus Christ in, he came into your life, Timothy. And what a joy it is to think of what God has been doing all these years, the ups, the downs, whatever it is, he's there with you, and you know that, and so you cling to him, and that brings me joy. But I remember that your faith is real. How do we know that's real in our lives? Well, there is fruit. Jesus talked about this. Paul talks about that. There's fruit in our lives that shows we belong to Jesus Christ. Things that we used to do that are wrong, God empowers us to say, no, I'm not going to do those anymore. We slip, we fall, but he's saying, get up, confess your sins. 1 John 1:9. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you. But you know what, Timothy? I know your family. Kind of indicates Paul has a little relationship with the rest of his family. Faith that was in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois. I remember the day I came into Asia Minor. I remember the day when I came to your village, and there was your grandmother Lois, who's been waiting to hear the message of the gospel because she's a believer in God and knows that there's a Messiah coming, and I proclaimed the Messiah to her, and she said, I'll take him as my Savior. I'll give my life to him. And then your mother Eunice did the same thing. And here's your heritage. Here's your spiritual heritage in your family. We don't get any explanation about the father. We don't know anything about him. Hopefully he came to faith in Christ, but we don't know. But we do know this, and Timothy knows his heritage. And Paul, in saying that, just says, family is important, and family that trusts Christ is important. And Timothy, I'm so glad that you have this heritage, your grandmother, your mother, and I am persuaded at the end of verse 5, I am persuaded is in you also. You've got the same salvation that they have, because there's only one real Savior, and his name is Jesus Christ. And we need him today just as much as Timothy needed him back then. So there's a lot there. And so this genuine faith, we see kind of a list there. Lois, Eunice, Timothy. that have been affected by God and have put their faith in Jesus Christ and have seen their sins forgiven. The genuine faith there might be called saving faith. That's where we put, where the Spirit of God works in our life to the point where we surrender and give ourselves to Him and we start following Jesus Christ. In chapter 3 of 2 Timothy, down in verse, to see what this all kind of fits together, down in verse 14, it says, "But you must continue in the things which you have heard and have been assured of, knowing from whom you've learned them, and from childhood you've known the Holy Scriptures." So that indicates that Lois and Eunice came to faith in their life while Timothy was young, and they continued to teach the Word of God, to share the Word of God, to grow in his sight. And so Paul reminds him of this in the third chapter, that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Jesus Christ. And then this great verse, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work." And we see great bits of truth in this book that Paul writes, or this letter that Paul writes to Timothy. And I could go down and just pull through things in each chapter and each verse, and they're verses that we know. They're verses that we've heard. And all of them are to bring encouragement as we face an uncertain future. And Paul knew his time was short. So back over to chapter 1 again, where we stopped, and then verse 6, it says, "Therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands." Somehow, and we don't know what it is, maybe it's the gift of teaching, gift of preaching, somehow when Paul understood the calling of God in the life of Timothy, that he said, "I was there, God has gifted you." Now, you know, maybe you've had some rough times, maybe you've had some unpleasant experiences, but you got to remember God has given you this gift. Stir it up, shake it up, get it moving again, and get back behind that pulpit and start to talk to the believers about how they can grow in their faith and how they can find new life in Jesus Christ. Don't give up. Keep going, Timothy. And that's what Paul is encouraging him. "Therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands." I was there when God called you to do that. Just like Ananias in chapter 9 was there when Paul had those scales in his eyes and God sent him, "Go tell this Saul that he's got a job to do." And Ananias says, wait a minute, God, that guy's no good. That guy's, he's here trying to arrest us and he's killing us, and you got the wrong guy. Does God ever have the wrong guy? Never, never. He says, "Don't worry about it. Just do what I tell you to do." And I said, "Okay, well, I guess I'm going to die, but I'll go do this." And he was wrong. He didn't die. But Paul was commissioned to go to the Gentiles then. And I'm sure that whatever he saw in Timothy and he saw God's leading in his life, he said, "I knew what my mission was, and now I see your mission is you got to take over when I'm gone." And so that's what Paul reminds him. And it's a commitment that's there. Stir up the gift of God in you. And then he goes in verse 7, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear." Starts out with a negative right away. Here's what God hasn't given you. He's given you a lot of stuff, but let me tell you one thing he hasn't given you, and some of you are just, Timothy, sometimes you're just overwhelmed by this. A spirit of fear. We don't need to fear. Here's Paul, who's been beaten and shipwrecked and all the things that happened in his life. He's in a dungeon now. He says, "But we don't need to fear. God's in charge. He's there with us. He hasn't given us a spirit of fear." So quit being fearful and say, "I don't know how to do that. Pastor, I don't know how to do that. I don't either." But here's what God says we do have. And he goes on. I like this. Great list. Don't God has not given you this, but look what he's given you. Power. A spirit of power. A spirit of love. And a spirit of sound mind. That's what God has given him. You know that last phrase, sound mind, right thinking, thinking the right way. When we keep our focus on Jesus Christ, when he is who we're looking at and we're following, then we're going to see these things develop in our life. And that's what Paul's reminding Timothy, that you have the power you need. You've got a love that's beyond comprehension in your relationship with the God of heaven, which then comes down into the relationships you have in this world, a love that's beyond the kind of love the world thinks is important. And then you have sound mind. You can think correctly. Romans 12:2 says that we should have our minds transformed, renewed. And it's the Word of God that can do that. But when I think of that word sound mind, it took me to a passage in Mark chapter 5. And you can just listen, verses 15 through 20. But here's what it says. And it's the story of the demon-possessed man that Jesus encounters. And it says, then they came to Jesus after he had cast the demons out, and they went into the pigs. The pigs went over the cliff. Remember the story? Okay, so all that takes place. And it comes to this point in the story. Then they came to Jesus and saw the one who had been demon-possessed. I love this verse. And had legion. That was the name of the demons that were in there. And here's what he saw. He was sitting. Luke says he was sitting at Jesus' feet. He was sitting and clothed and in his right mind. You see, when we surrender to Jesus Christ, our thinking is going to change because we're going to think like he thinks. We're going to think the things that he wants us to think. And the place I find them is in here. This is his word. And so we study it and we apply it and we grow in our relationship. But here's the rest of that story of the demon-possessed man. Down in verse 18 it says, and when he got into the boat, that's Jesus, when he got into the boat, he who had been demon-possessed begged Jesus that he might go with him. Can I get in? Can I come? Jesus did not permit him. Now, you see, well, that's kind of rough. This guy's had a really bad experience, and now he's been set free from that, and he needs to spend some time with you. And you know, the good news is God always knows how much time we need in some area of our life. And so Jesus saw his life transformed, and the guy knew his life was transformed. So Jesus did not permit him, but said to him, go home to your family. Go home to your family. Your friends, and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you. Go and tell the world how God has changed your life. And you're no longer this person over here. You are a new creature in Christ, and you are changing more and more all the time. And God still changes lives. Tell what great things the Lord has done for you and how he had compassion on you. And he departed and began to proclaim in the Decapolis, 4 or 10 town area, all that Jesus had done for him, and all marveled. This is a great letter that Paul sent to Timothy, but he sent it to you and me as well. And if you've never invited Jesus Christ to be your Savior, this would be a great day to do that. Simply say, God, I know I'm a sinner. I can't save myself. I believe that Jesus Christ came and died on the cross for my sins. And you simply say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart and forgive my sins and make me a new person. And if you do that, what's going to happen? He's going to come in, right? Jerry and Kay get to see kids all summer long transformed in front of them as they invite Jesus to be their Savior. And that brings joy, doesn't it? Joy. All right, I could go on and on and on, and you're saying, well, yeah, I hope you don't. I'm kind of in a predicament here because I really, this passage is important, and I'm glad we looked at this thing because we can have joy. But I said earlier, everybody has a story, and I have a story. And since I'm here preaching, you need to know something about me. I grew up in a really good home, nice family. We went to church all the time. I didn't really care about church that much, and the type of church it was a little different than here. And I don't ever remember being asked if Jesus was my Savior. I don't know, and maybe I just didn't pay any attention. But it was a church that I would identify as that they didn't have a high view of Scripture. It's just like it's more like a springboard, grab a verse, jump in, and maybe talk about something that had to do with it. And my thought was from that church that do the best you can, and you might get to heaven if there is a heaven. You know, so that's the philosophy I had in my life. And then I graduated from high school, went to Ohio University, didn't really know what I was going to do. It was set up for engineering, some kind of engineering. But my life was just a life of going to parties. Ohio University is one of the top party schools in the nation back then. It may still be, I don't know. So I went to the bars. There's at least two bars in every block, and you spend time there every night. And what I found out was that you can't get up for an 8 o'clock class if you've been to the bar till it closed, or you couldn't get up very often. Get there. So I had a calculus class that I skipped half the time, and whenever the final was there, I couldn't even understand any of the questions. So I failed that class. An extreme new educational policy at Ohio University then, and that was that if you failed a class, you can just, it's like it's been wiped from the record, like you never took it. So it didn't average in your grade. And you can do that with D's if you chose to, D's and F's. And so at the end of my first year at Ohio University, out of a possible 46 quarter hours, because we were on quarters then, I had 29. So I did a lot of wiping away. So my average didn't look too bad, but it was bad. What happened was in 1972, I came home for summer break, and there's a letter on the drain board that says, "Greetings, you've been inducted into the United States Army." And so I got drafted. So I went from this party lifestyle to this regimented lifestyle of basic training and the Army and so forth. And so God is working in my life beyond ways that I would understand. So I made it through basic training. Then I was assigned to go to military police training, then to correctional specialist training, where you're a prison guard. And so training for the first 6 months of the two-year period, it's in training. And in the process, I didn't find answer. I remember in basic training, when it was really a rough day, I had a little Gideon New Testament that was given to me some group that was there when we were brought in. So I found that New Testament, and I started trying to read it, and I was in Matthew 1, and it said, so-and-so begat so-and-so, begat so-and-so, and I thought, what is a begat? You know, I don't know what a begat is. So I kind of threw that aside, forgot about it for several months, and then when I was stationed in Fort Campbell, Kentucky, for the duration of my time in the service, I started to have questions. Watergate was going on, didn't understand that. The first Middle East oil crisis was on when gas went up to 40 cents a gallon, and we were terrified. And personally, my brother was going through a divorce, and I just couldn't understand how this couple that loved each other could go through this. And I started asking questions. And what happened was I remember I picked up a New Testament again. This time I was working at the post stockade, which is like a county jail for the Army. They had a stack that the Gideons had put there. I grabbed that, and I just skipped over the begats because I thought, I don't understand that. Well, I'll keep reading. Then I came to the Christmas story. Oh, yeah, I remember that, bits and pieces of that. And then I got past that, and all of a sudden this is all new territory. But I didn't know this, but the Spirit of God was working in my life because I was searching for something. I didn't know what it was, but I thought maybe I could find it in the Bible. So I started, and I said, as I started in the Gospels, I started to see unfold before me the person of Jesus Christ. I thought, man, I remember the story of his birth, and I don't understand much about that Easter thing, but here's Jesus, and every time he encounters someone, they go away different. Either they decide to follow him, or they decide to reject him. And either way, they came away different once they encountered Jesus Christ. And I remember seeing and the miracles taking place and lives changed. And I remember reading through those things and I'm thinking, man, if I could have lived back then, if I could have known Jesus, my life would be different. And then I keep reading. And then I always kind of had a hard time when I came to the end of the gospel. And there's the crucifixion. And I think, if he's the Son of God, why did God let them do that to him? And if all he ever did was good, why would anybody want to kill him? Didn't make any sense to me. And I just scratch my head, and then I start the next gospel. And somewhere halfway through the Gospel of Luke, a friend of mine who was a believer was starting to talk to the prisoners and share the gospel with them. And I kind of stood off to the side and listened to what he had to say. And I remember one time I must have read some verse that he quoted, and I told him, I pulled him aside and said, "Hey, Wes, you know, I just read that you were sharing there the other day." And he said, "You're reading the Bible?" I said, because I wasn't really too nice to him before. And I said, "Well, yeah, I am reading the Bible, and I just don't understand some things. And the first thing is, I don't understand why Christ died. Sick of no bulldog, right?" He said, "Well, let me tell you why Christ died." Took me to Romans and went through what's kind of known as the Romans Road. He came to Romans 3:23, says, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And so that's me, and that's everybody else I've ever seen. Seems you guys think they're pretty good, but they're not. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then Romans 5:8, which is a life verse that I hang on to, says, "But God commends his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." And all of a sudden the light went off. Why did Jesus Christ die? He died for me. He died for me. He died so I could live. And I dealt by my bed. I lived in a off base in a mobile home with a married couple, and I had a bedroom there, and I knelt by my bed and said, "Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know I can't save myself. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. Would you come into my heart and be my Savior?" He did. And I'm looking at a group of people that you've had that experience. He came in. And I have that Gideon New Testament. It's pretty worn out now. But in the back page, there's a little thing, and a little thing that says, "I, Neil Reed, invited Jesus Christ to be my Savior on March 18th, 1974. And you know what? He's still my Savior. I would have never dreamed, I'd be standing at a pulpit talking to people about anything. As a matter of fact, I was terrified if there's three people as an audience. And so when God, and this is a whole, I can't go through this whole story, and we're out of, we're way out of time, but he also called me into ministry. And I said, no, I'll go get a job, make lots of money, give it to the church, and I'll help out. And he said, no, you got to go teach the word of God. And I've done that various ways. Thank you for listening. And I hope that Jesus Christ is becoming more and more visible in your life. One of the things we do in the prison is try to take in Jesus Christ in the lives we live so that people can see him. Philippians 2, I'll close with this. Philippians 2, verses 3 and 4 says, "Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for your own interests, but also for the interests of others." You see, that's the Christian life. That's the demonstration of genuine faith. that we put others first and always, always point to Jesus. Just bow with me. Father, we thank you for the time we've had in your word. We thank you for you being with us through this whole service. What a great time it has been to be singing songs of praise and praying and then just searching your scriptures. Help us to get closer to you, no matter what, that we keep Jesus Christ in the center of our lives so that we can grow in our faith, but also we can impact the world in which you live. Thank you that you never give up on us. And Father, help us not to give up on one another. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.